join to your dance, a tribute to Busby Berkeley. Kevin Daly here with a special tribute to a man who perhaps more than any other typified the glamorous days of the Hollywood musical, Busby Berkeley. Bus Berkeley had everything in his films: lavish, expensive sets, the most lovely chorus, the majestic Vitaphone Symphony Orchestra, and, most importantly, his own talent as an inventive choreographer. His stars had a charm and a vitality that still delights. Ruby Keeler, Dick Powell, Ginger Rogers, Joan Blondell, James Cagney, all tapped their way to stardom in Busby Berkeley pictures. The titles themselves evoke that glittering era of Hollywood in the 30s. Films like Hollywood Hotel, Going to Your Dance, Dames, Footlight Parade, and of course that whole series of Goldinger's films of 1933, 35, 37, and a rather curious concoction starring Rudy Vallée called Goldinger's in Paris. Well, for the next hour, we're going to give a musical salute to Busby Berkeley and the many songs from his productions in new recordings specially made by the ABC. Kevin Hocking and his orchestra provide a luxurious musical backcloth, recreating the style of the original Vitaphone Orchestra, and the lyrics are sung by that very talented vocal group, the Ritz Company. We'll also hear from Ruby Keeler, who starred in many of Busby Berkeley's movies. And here's the man himself, talking in 1965 to Mitchell Raper of the BBC.
The staple ingredient of all your spectaculars, of course, was girls. Where did you find them? How did you find them?
Well, I just have a call for girls. I was going to do a musical, and then, you know, a lot of them would show up, and I would pick those girls that I thought were beautiful.
You may have been misquoted, but I heard that you had a kind of permanent nucleus, and you built your battalions of girls around them.
No. In one way, that's true. Another way, it isn't. I had 16 girls that I had Warner Brothers sign up and put under contract because they were so beautiful. The other girls always came and were a part of each picture. But I always kept these 16 girls because they were the nucleus of beauty.
Dear Mr. Berkeley, I'm writing this to say
Did you, in fact, have any formal training as a choreographer?
No, never. No. I did many Broadway shows before I went to Hollywood.
Well, how did these incredibly intricate, complicated spectaculars come to be made? How did you plan them?
Well, I don't know. It's all I can tell you, to be very frank, is they were just ideas that I created in my mind and wanted to put on the screen.
What I'm getting at is, what sort of idea did you, for instance, think of having girls form into the patterns of a flower or something like that and work from that, or did you start with a tune? Or?
No, I always start with a tune. Not always, but yes, the tune I have to start with, because it's the melody that inspires me. Then the lyrics, very important to me, what the song is about. Then I have to put my interpretation of that number on the screen for the entertainment of the public.
When Buzz Berkeley was summoned to Hollywood in 1930 by Sam Goldwyn, it was to create the dances for Whoopee, starring Eddie Cantor, who had already had a smash hit with a show on Broadway. Cantor and Goldwyn wanted someone who could add zest and imagination to the stage routines, so they came to Buzz. He was a much sought-after theatre dance director and was already developing that technique of placing his dancers in a kaleidoscopic fashion around the stage. And he arranged his routines around the actual rhythmic structure of the music in quite a new way. Here's one of the hit songs from Whoopee, Walter Donaldson and Gus Kahn's My Baby Just Cares for Me.
I'm so happy since the day I fell in love in a great big way, and the big surprise is someone loves me too. Guess it's hard for you to see just what anyone can see in me, but it simply goes to prove what love can do.
My baby don't care for shows, my baby don't care for clothes, my baby just cares for me. My baby don't care for boys and ladies, my baby don't care for high-tech races, my baby don't care.
Musical you made in Hollywood, in which, of course, Ruby Keeler was also a star, and we'll be asking about that in a moment. This was the 42nd Street for Warner Brothers and was something of a rescue operation.
Yes, it was. I didn't learn this till about 3 years later.
Why was the rescue necessary?
Well, because Warner Brothers, at that time, was in the red. They were in terrific financial difficulties. And they were going to take one more chance on a musical to see if that would help them come out of the red. So Zanuck called me and said, don't go back to New York and do any more Broadway. Stay out here and do all the musical numbers for 42nd Street, will you? Going to take one more fling at a musical. No one would do them then. So I said I would. And as a result, we did 42nd Street.
Ruby Keeler, am I right in thinking that you were one of the girls who graduated either from Mr. Berkeley's chorus line or from the outer circle? How did you get into 42nd Street?
No, I had been in the theater as a dancer, and 20th Century Fox, but I don't remember whether it was 20th or Fox, but anyway, they made a test of me. I was in California, and they made a test, and I guess at that time, Warners were going to do this musical picture, and
this desperate rescue operation picture. Yeah.
I was a dancer, and they had heard about me making a test at Fox, and they sent for the test. They signed me from that test to do the picture.
One of the things which I can't help noticing is the contrast between you kicking up your heels right up in the front of the set and the rather more regimented girls behind. I was wondering, were you ever allowed to improvise your steps at all?
Well, the dances that I did were my dances.
Yes.
But when I had the privilege of working in the numbers with Buzz, you know, as being part of the great big thing, why, naturally, that was all Buzz.
In the heart of little old New York, you'll find a thoroughfare. It's the part of little old New York that runs into Times Square. A crazy
empties from the 50s, innocent and sweet. Sexy ladies from the 80s who are indiscreet, dressed side by side, they're glorified. Where the underworld can be the elite, 42nd Street.
Time when money was pretty tight, the time of the Depression. Was it difficult to raise money for the kind of expensive production numbers that you were making?
Well, now, you see, I was never in the business of raising money. That was up to the studio, and they cost money. But they evidently had confidence in me and liked what I was doing, and as long as they're going to take one last gamble on a musical, they let me have all the money I needed to get what I needed for what I was doing.
And the films were designed to be an antidote to depression, blues, and worries. With millions out of work, Berkeley's cheerful, fast-moving films provided elegant escapism. But in Gold Diggers of 1933, he presented a different kind of number. Remember My Forgotten Man. This was harsh social comment, making a plea for the unemployed ex-serviceman who'd been hit hard. As a plea for the unemployed, its message is just as moving 50 years later as we move out of a second Great Depression.
Remember my forgotten man. You put a rifle in his hand. Send him far away. Shouted hip hooray, but look at him today. Remember my forgotten man. You had him cultivate the land. He walked behind a plow, the sweat fell from his brow, but look at him right now. And once he used to love, I was happy then. He used to take care of me won't you bring him back again? For ever since the world began, a woman's got to have a man. Forgetting him, you see, you're forgetting me, like my forgotten man. I was satisfied to drift along from day to day, till you came and took my man away. Remember my forgotten man. You put a rifle in his hand, sent him far away. Shouted him hooray, but look at him today. Remember my forgotten man. You had him cultivate the land. Walked behind a plow, the sweat fell from his brow, but look at him right now. I was happy then. He used to take care of me. Won't you bring him back again? For ever since the world began, a woman's got to have a man.
Now, the film musical was clearly becoming a new medium of expression, with the screen and the camera expanding the staging of musical numbers to a point that no theatre could contain, whatever its budget or facilities. It could also be seen simultaneously, all over the world, even in the smallest towns. And Busby Berkeley had precisely that kind of fertile visual mind needed for these musical comedy extravaganzas. Gold Diggers of 1933 followed the pattern of 42nd Street, a fast-moving story of backstage life intercut with elaborate tuneful production numbers, and it was a style that Berkeley would develop and polish throughout the 30s. Here's the theme song, We're in the Money.
We're in the money, come on my honey, Let's bend it, land it, send it, roll it right along.
Making films in the early 1930s, the equipment then was considerably more primitive than it is today. Did you find this a great problem?
Well, it was every now and then, because they were so used to doing things the way they'd been doing them for years. And I'd start to move a camera and they said, Buzz, you can't do that. I said, oh, yes, you can. Oh, you no, can. You can't. Well, I said, let's try it anyway. Let's try and see if we can. And I always did.
You were, in fact, a technical innovator.
Yes, on many things.
Such as?
Well, such as a crane that you put the camera on the end that goes around with the camera. Everyone knows a crane by now. Well, it wouldn't do a lot of the things for me that I wanted it to do. So I devised and sketched out what I wanted and gave it to the engineers, and they built it. And that was a monorail that ran the whole length of the stage with only two operators. One gauged the speed forward and backward, fast or slow, than I wanted, and the other carried the camera platform with the camera on it and the operator. And that was the other operator controlled that. And they both worked, and I had to synchronize both men so that they would do exactly with that camera, exactly where I wanted to go, when I wanted to go, hold it so long, and so on.
The simple things, 'cause I'm awfully fond of getting love in a natural setting. This is what I call the simple things, just a winding stream where I can drift and dream, and now I'm waiting for you. and share it all beneath a ceiling of blue. We'll spend the heavenly day here where the whispering waters blend. There's a whippoorwill that's calling you. By a waterfall he's dreaming too. There's a magic melody Mother Nature sings to me beside a waterfall with you.
By a waterfall
looking at these films that you made, there seems to be a particular 1930s type who appears. Would you say this is correct? Was there a 1930s type of beauty, and if so,
no.
What was it?
No, I couldn't say so. I think beauty is beauty. Doesn't make any difference what year it comes in. They're either beautiful or they're not. They're
what
either
kind of
gorgeous.
Beauty were you looking for?
Oh, I was looking for the gorgeous type, for the... There are many things you think of when you're picking a girl, like for the theater. Remember Ziegfeld used to say when I was picking girls for Whoopi, I picked them, not him. But he'd say, what did you pick that one for? Well, I said, don't you understand that there are people in the audience, the man in the front row on this side likes the slender girl, looks athletic. So I pick a slender girl to please him. A lady back of him likes the ethereal type, the one that's almost like a Madonna. In other words, everybody in the audience had their likes and dislikes.
Fate sent her to me over the sea from Spain. She's one in a million for me. I found my romance when she went dancing by. She must be a Castilian. Castilian, see, see. Is she from Havana or Madrid? But
about her is making me doubt her. I think I remember the kid.
On the left from Manhattan.
You can tell by her manana.
On the left from Manhattan.
But not Havana. Though she does love the forest. And she calls herself Dolores.
I was in a Broadway chorus.
Known as Susie Donahue. She can take a tambourine and whack it, but to her it's just a racket.
On the hook of Front 10th Avenue.
She's a lad from Manhattan. She's a 46th Streeter. She's a lad from Manhattan. Senorita Donahue. Have you ever met the girl who's the toast of the town? Oh, what a heart without a question. Who gives your heart a quick congestion?
Say, have you ever met the dream in the red velvet gown?
If you will pardon my suggestion, you'd better write her number down. The Valentine, all the movies are after. She won't sign, cause she really don't have to. I declare, for a lady in red. The fellas are crazy for the lady in red. She's a bit goody, but lordy, what a personality. Oh, the lady in red. It's fresh as a daisy when the town is in bed. Dancing and dining and shining with originality. She's very proper. She's nothing more than a pal. But oh, me and oh my, you never stop her. She'd be a dangerous gal if she should ever think the right guy for the lady.
The Lady in Red from In Caliente, and She's a Latin from Manhattan from Go Into Your Dance. This last film is unique amongst Busby Berkeley's output in that despite having a huge star in the person of Al Jolson and some of his most exotic sequences, there is no mention of Berkeley in the film's credits. Why? Well, in the September of 1935, Busby Berkeley attended a party given by Bill Koenig, Warner's production manager. He had to leave early to keep an appointment with the band leader Gus Arnheim, and as he was driving along the winding Pacific Coast Highway, the left-hand front tire of his car blew out and he shot into the path of the oncoming traffic. In the resulting head-on collision, two people were killed and a third died later. Buzz himself was dragged unconscious from his burning car. The police insisted that he was drunk, and he was tried for manslaughter. Two trials resulted in a hung jury, but at a third trial he was finally found not guilty. It had been a time of great strain and worry. Warner Brothers restored his name to the credits of his next movie, Stars Over Broadway, but they'd kept his participation to a minimum, just in case he should be found guilty and end up in jail. All he had to do were a few fairly routine dance ensembles. But the film did produce one of the great standard songs of the 30s.
Thank you. don't remember that September. The sun went out just like a dying ember that September in the rain.
To every word of love I heard you whisper, the raindrops
spring is here to me, it's still September, that September in the
September in the Rain from Stars Over Broadway, the Ritz Company with Kevin Hocking and his orchestra. By the mid-30s, Buzz Berkeley was creating his own wonderful world full of photographic tricks with hordes of pretty girls performing amazing and energetic routines. He was exciting and daring and made his own rules, and in the process made a lot of money. All through the decade, he dominated Warner Brothers' musical world with his geometric patterns, bizarre montages of camera angles, his cascades of designs, and his famous overhead shots.
Oh, I had to, because on some shots, you see, I originated the top shot that's shooting straight down. Mm. And I got up in the rafters one day, and I started to look down. I don't know why I went up there. I just thought, I wonder what this might look like. So I create everything for the camera. So I looked down, and Daryl Zanuck, who was then the head of Warner Brothers, came on the set, and he said, "Buzz, what are you doing up there?" Oh, I said, "I'm just looking around, looking down." Well, he said, "You can't take the audience up there." I said, "I know I can't, but I'd like to. It looks awfully pretty from up here." Well, he said, "Don't shoot anything from up there, you know, because you couldn't take the audience up." I said, "Oh, no, I won't." But I did. And he loved it.
The lullaby on Broadway, the rumble of the subway train, the rattle of the taxis, the daffy deals to entertain, at Angelo's and Maxie's. When Broadway baby says goodnight, it's early in the morning, and at the baby's never sleep at night, they wait till the dawn. Oh, good night. Kiss me goodnight, baby. Good night. Oh, can't you see that the milkman's coming our way? Good night, baby. Good night. Let's call it a day. Come on along and listen to the hi-ho and hooper do. Bend that ear and you'll hear the lullaby of Broadway. The band begins to go to town. You rock the by your baby round. You get crazy, your mind gets hazy. Listen to the lullaby of Broadway.
Come come on along, come on along, come on along, come on along.
The rumble of the subway train, the rattle of the taxis, the daffodils who entertain at Angelo's and Maxie's. When the Broadway baby says goodnight, it's early in the morning. Manhattan babies never sleep at night. They wait till the dawn. Oh, good night. Kiss me good night, baby. Good night.
Oh, can't you see that the milkman's coming our way?
Good night, baby. Good night. Let's call it a day. Listen to the lullaby of old Broadway. Broadway. Broadway.
Lullaby of Broadway, the blockbuster finale to The Gold Diggers of 1935. A year earlier, in 1934, Busby Berkeley had made his ultimate tribute to gorgeous girls in a film succinctly entitled Dames. By far the most memorable part is the song and dance routine for I Only Have Eyes for You. Dick Powell and Ruby Keeler meet in front of a cinema, then take a long subway ride where they both fall asleep. As Dick Powell dreams, battalions of girls appear, all wearing masks of ruby, so that an army of Keelers ascends the screen. At the end of the song, each girl, now with a board on her back, turns around, and by fitting the boards together, a huge jigsaw picture of Ruby Keeler's face appears. I Only Have Eyes for You, from Dames.
My love must be a kind of blind love. I can't see anyone but you. And dear, I wonder if you'll find love an optical illusion too. Are the stars out tonight? I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you, dear. The moon may be high, but I can't see a thing in the sky, 'cause I only have eyes for you. I don't know if we're in a garden, of people go by, but they all disappear from you.
Thank you.
maybe millions of people go by, but they all disappear from view. And I only have eyes for you.
I've noticed that over and over again in your performances, you give the same sort of impression of the same sort of girl, someone who's wide-eyed and innocent and a little overwhelmed by the sudden access of fame.
Yes.
Was this you, or was it a deliberately conceived
image? I'm afraid it was me.
You danced often with Dick Powell. Was this a case of two stars under contract with the same studio, or did you work up a particular rapport with him?
No. 42nd Street was also Dick's first picture. And whatever happened in that picture, the Warner Brothers seemed to think that we were a good pair. I don't know why.
Did they ever try you with anybody else?
Just once. Mm-hmm. And this was all about my fourth picture or fifth picture, I don't know. And made the entire picture. And, of course, they didn't tell me anything, but the picture was finished, and I had a call to come back the next day for the same scene, and I thought, well, a retake or something. But they'd gotten a little nervous, and I remade the picture with Dick.
I'm young and healthy, and you've got charms. It would really be a sin not to have you in my arms. I'm young and healthy, and so are you. When the moon is in the sky, tell me, what am I to do? If I should hate you, I'd keep away. But that ain't my nature. I'm full of vitamin A, say.
Petting in the park,
and healthy
boy.
Petting in the dark,
bad girl.
First you walk a little, and talk a little, then you steal a little kiss. Petting in the park,
bad boy.
Petting in the dark,
bad girl.
Struggle just a little, then hug a little, cuddle up and whisper this.
Come on,
I've been waiting long, why don't we get started?
Come on,
maybe this is wrong,
but gee, what of it? We just love it.
Petting in the park, you forget to be the lonely tandem.
Petting in the dark,
ooh, off we're gonna shuffle.
Petting in the park,
through Niagara in a sleeper. There's no honeymoon that's cheaper, and the train goes slow. Ooh, off we're gonna shuffle. Shuffle up to Buffalo.
When I worked in the numbers, I didn't realize that Buzz was the genius that he is. So I just sit there and marvel at the synchronization of the music and of the camera and just everything.
Now, what about you? How does Ruby Keeler of 1950s?
Now, you want me to answer that?
Yes,
Well, now, first place, I just die when I hear myself sing. I cringe. But then I did then. I just didn't. I knew I couldn't sing, and I didn't want to sing, but I did. And if you notice, I would ask them to, please, may I just sing the middle, you know, not where you go da-da-da-da-da, you know, just right there. And they were kind enough to let me do that.
How do your pictures look to you, Mr. Berkeley?
Well, I, first time I've seen them in 30 years. And I get quite a kick, shall we say, out of watching them.
So do I.
And particularly the response of the people who watch them, the older generation and the younger generation especially, because quite evidently and obviously they have never seen things like this on the screen, because they were little babies, little kids when I was doing these.
In that tribute to the director and choreographer Busby Berkeley, the songs were sung by the Brits Company with Kevin Hocking and his orchestra. We also heard the recorded voices of Mitchell Raper, Ruby Keeler, and Busby Berkeley. Technical production was by Warwick Naber and Neil Sandbach. The program was compiled and produced by Kevin Daly.
Hooray for Hollywood! Let's go away, ballyhooey, Hollywood! Any office boy or young mechanic can be a panic with just a good-looking pan.
And any shop girl can be a top girl if she pleases the tired businessman.
Hooray for Hollywood! You may be homely in your neighborhood.
Anyone who wants to be an actor, go see Max Factor. He'll make your kisser look good.
Go out and try your luck. You may be Donald Duck. Hooray for Hollywood. Hooray for Hollywood. That woolly, wild and woolly Hollywood.
They hire cowboys and they hang their chaps up and doll their maps up and give them all that they lack.
Now ain't it funny, they pay their money. Shows what you can do if your horse can act.
Hooray for Hollywood! They hire fellas whose physiques are good.
And then they tell them they're the perfect shape men to act like ape men, and they convince them they should.
They make them grunt and yell,
oh!